Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's open our service this morning and stand and sing God Bless America. Stand as we sing.
What a wonderful song, and one of the best places to sing that is in Grafton, West Virginia on Memorial Day weekend. And so this is just a lot of excitement in the air. Jeannie and I with the Spirit of Grafton yesterday, and of course the parade's coming up tomorrow, and we just want to pray for no rain, and we've had a lot of it today, so if we pray enough, perhaps the Lord will hold the rain off so that we can have an enjoyable parade as usual. But it's good to have you here. This morning, if you're a newcomer with us, we have little blue cards in the pew racks. If you would take that card and complete it and put it in the offering plate when it comes by, that will allow us to express to you how glad we were to have you here this morning. But we hope you're blessed by the singing, by the sharing, by everything that takes place in this service today. This is also Graduate Recognition Sunday. And we have a special graduate here that we would like to recognize, a member of our congregation, Miss Morgan Griffith. So Morgan, would you come up now and receive a gift Bible that we have for you? I asked her if this would be okay, because some folks would feel like they were put on the spot. And she said, yeah, this would be okay. So, but God bless you. We love you. We're praying for you. This is a big deal for anybody. It's a big deal for Morgan especially. So I want us as a church family, and you're going to hear more about this later, about the power of a church praying for a young person, but I want us to pray together for Morgan now, and let's continue to pray for her as she goes out into the next chapter of her life, that God will guide her and provide for her and protect her in every way. So let's pray for Morgan. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Morgan. We thank you for her life. We thank you, Father, for her devotion to you. We thank you for her family. We thank you for the blessing that she is to this congregation. We pray now that as she graduates and as she goes on to another chapter of her life, that you would just give her wisdom and guidance in all the decisions that she makes. Father, may she always be grounded in your word. May she always be led by your spirit. And may her family just continue to encourage her and be of support to her as they've been to this point. Father, use us as a church congregation to minister to her as well, to show the kind of love that only the body of Christ can give. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you, Morgan. We love you. Now, let's just pray once more for the entire service today. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time we have to come together. We thank you for the opportunity we've just had to pray for Morgan. And we ask that we would just continue in that as she goes on with the life that you've set in front of her. We pray, Father, for this service this morning, that through the singing, through the sharing, the fellowship, the proclamation of your word, that all of these things would blend together in a fashion that glorifies Christ and that points our attention to him. Father, we pray for those who may be struggling in various ways today. Minister to them through your word and through the presence of your people. Father, we know that you can do all things. And so we look to you and we entrust our lives to you, that you would have your way and your will with us. For it's in Christ's powerful and precious name that we pray. Amen.
This time, Jay is going to come share our announcements.
Morning.
Good morning.
All right. Let's see here. We got a lot of different things we're getting going on here. Now, we're always looking for volunteers for the nursery and children's church. So if you can help with that, please see Janice or Pastor there to sign up for that. Lots of fun with that. Speaking of that, down in the nursery today, I guess there's no one working in the nursery. So if you're taking your kids down there, hey, you volunteered for it. Is that how we're doing it? All right, there we go. And then also, I guess this weekend, Pat White let us know that it's their 60th class reunion, and I guess they are honoring Pastor McDonald at that one, so just be aware of that. And okay, our Memorial Day parade tomorrow. Wait a minute, there we go. Yesterday I sent to Marilyn, I said, hey, can you put on the prayer list, we're praying for coolers. And then she just sends out this little thing saying, hey, don't forget your coolers. I was like, no, we're praying. We need lots more coolers. So, yeah. If you've brought a cooler, thank you. If you haven't and you got one we can use, we really need it. So this is coming together nicely. Now, for tomorrow, if you're wanting to walk with us, we do need plenty of helpers to help pass out the waters and everything. We'll be up at the bank there in Blueville at 8 o'clock. And then anybody that's wanting to meet with and walk with us, if you want to get together down there at the towers, we'll be coming through there later. So kind of get down there around. The parade starts at 10, and then, everything, takes us a little while to get down the hill there for when our place is. But then we can hook up there when we come through. And that seems to work pretty good in the years past. So, but we need as many people as we can to kind of pass out waters. We'll have like about 4 wagons there, and the more people there are to hand out waters, the easier it goes. So, really looking forward to that. And if you guys have any questions, Melinda's here today, and just let her know. And we've had a really, really great time with this. It's a great opportunity for us to just kind of community outreach with, especially we got on our labels there on the waters. So, all right, let's see here. What else we got? Oh, on your insert in there, you've got the whole June activities. Cannot believe June is here. So there's the calendar on the back table you got there with that. So you got everything going on in June. Then the Union Association Revival and the Women's Conference there listed. So be sure to check all that out. And let's see here, what else did we have? Okay, I think this is the time when Marilyn is gonna come. Oh, no, wait, oh yeah, you talk about this too, right? Yeah, here we go. So Marilyn's gonna talk about this and then some other things and then read some stuff and do scripture and everything. So there we go.
This is our ladies group. We rented the handicap cabin at the lake for one of our meetings, which really wasn't a meeting. It ended up being party and fun. But we had a campfire. Some of us spent the night. We had a wonderful time laughing and sharing, and so much so that they want to do that again. Probably this fall we'll do it again. So any of you ladies who didn't go, you missed out on a whole bunch of fun. The next thing I'll talk about is most of you were handed these pink sheets as you came in. Something really excited about. I wasn't aware that we had a pregnancy crisis center until a pastor told me recently. Diana and I checked it out, and we are so eager to help this organization. Small little place over in Clarksburg. What's its actual name, Pastor? Life Choice. And, you know, as Christians, we're pro-life and anti-abortion. This gives us some way to do more than just complain about it and more to pray. We can actually be proactive and take part and support them. So lots of little projects we can do. There's a sign-up sheet back there if any of you ladies want to go with us and tour it. We'd love to have you go. We want you to see it firsthand. We think you'll be as excited about it as we are. The other thing is, my granddaughter Jada is on a year-long mission trip, spending a month in several different countries. She's been to 5 countries in South America, 2 countries in Asia, and 1 country already in Eastern Europe. She's just moved to Georgia, has Bulgaria and Spain to go, and then Portugal. So we won't see her till September. But she's been writing blogs and posting them online as she goes. And the most recent one is entitled, An Open Letter to Beulah Baptist. So as pastor, I said, there are some who may not get Facebook or things. Can I read it? So he's allowed me to. It's lengthy. But I want to read you what Jada has to say to you, her church. In Prettytown, West Virginia, alongside Route 50, there's a little white church. This church has been my home for 23 years. This is where my mother brought me as a newborn baby. This is where I came to salvation and was baptized. This is where I started and ended my acting career in Christmas plays. This is where I learned that Baptists like to eat a lot. I have cried, laughed, learned, worshiped, and rejoiced in those red pews in that church. This is where I grew up. This building and these memories have a special place in my heart, but none of them compare to the people who fill those pews. In my time on this race, that's what her mission trip is called, the race, I have seen and experienced the importance of church family, the purpose and necessity of having brothers and sisters in Christ who are devoted to one another. These experiences have led me to spend a lot of time thinking about the church I was raised in, the values I learned from them, and how grateful I am to call the members of Beulah Baptist my family. So this blog is for you, my wonderful Beulah Baptist family. 23 years ago as an infant, I was held up before you at my baby dedication, and as a church, you made a promise to come together with my family and raise me according to God's word. In that dedication ceremony, you promised to be examples to me, to pray for me, to be a wise counsel for me, and to love me. 23 years later, I can confidently say, you have not failed me. As a child, you faithfully taught me in Sunday school and youth group. Through your voices, I fell in love with the stories of the Bible. Through watching you all, I learned the importance of loving and serving others in whatever way I could. You taught me the importance of reading, studying, and memorizing God's word. Through the faithful members of the prayer chain, I learned the importance and the power of prayer. Through your families, I had countless examples of what it looks like to be a godly daughter, sister, or mother. And I'm positive I could come up with thousands of other ways you've influenced me and taught me, but I don't want to take this too long. I can't talk about the way this church has influenced me without mentioning Richard McDonald, Beulah's faithful preacher for the first 20 years of my life. Even at a young age, I remember sitting in awe of his wisdom and his knowledge. He could captivate the church with his passionate sermons, and I will forever treasure everything I learned from this incredible man of God. A few months ago, I uploaded some new pictures of my trip to Facebook, and the next time I logged on, so many of you women, and I'm sure she meant men too, she just didn't say it, have liked almost every photo I put and left thousands of comments. So I turned to my team and joked, I feel like I have 25 grandmas because every time I post something, I receive so much love from my gran and the other women in my church. A few weeks later, I video called my gran, and she happened to be at the Women's Spiritual Growth Retreat. She answered, and instantly two other heads popped in beside her and said, "Oh, that's Jada. Let's go outside and talk to her." It was so comforting and so sweet to see those faces from home. I hung up the call and sat in awe, on the verge of tears, because I know without a doubt that I am very loved. I was thinking about that love and felt God say, "That's how it's meant to be. That's how I created the church to function." God created the church with such a beautiful purpose. It's meant to be a family that's brought together because of Christ. A family where love runs deep, encouragement abounds, wisdom and knowledge are shared, and grace overflows there. The church is called to raise up disciples and bring the gospel to the ends of the earth. The church is so much more than a building you visit, than the hands you shake on Sunday morning. When I signed up for this race, I was unsure of leaving, terrified at the thought of fundraising all that money and being away from home for so long. I remember the first time I stood in front of you and announced this adventure. After the service, I was overwhelmed by the love and the support I received from you. You promised to support me in whatever way you could, and wow, you moved mountains to help me. I know that you've been praying for this time away ever since I announced it. You selflessly helped my fundraising journey through donations and serving at my fundraising events. I know that I would not be here today if I did not have you all. I know that just because I've been gone now for 9 months, that has not stopped you from encouraging me and praying for me. And I'm sure that you all have been comforting my family while I've been gone too. The love and support that you fill my life with means so much. So while I miss you all, I have to say, it's your fault that I'm gone. You inspired and equipped me so well that I could not say no when God's call came to me. So from the depths of my heart, I thank you. Thank you for 23 years of love, 23 years of your teaching, 23 years of your prayers, and 23 years of family. I cannot wait to be with you all again in just 3 short months. So, thank you for supporting our Jada. Okay, moving on to our scripture, Jude verses 1 through 4. Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James, to those who have been called, who are loved by God the Father and kept by Jesus Christ, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. Dear friends, although I was very eager to write to you about the salvation we share, I felt I had to write and urge you to contend for the faith that was once for all entrusted to the saints. For certain men, whose condemnation was written about long ago, have secretly slipped in among you. They are godless men who changed the grace of God into a license for immorality and deny Jesus Christ, our only sovereign and Lord. May God add blessings to the reading and hearing of his word.
Thank you very much, Marilyn, for all that. And let's get back to, there we go, there's birthdays. We got Bill Cox, Beverly Withers, Wayne Bell, David Wagner, Kara Breedlove, Charlotte Pisano, Jade Holly, and Cambry Delaney. And anniversaries, we got Alan and Andrea Mayle, Lauren and Sonia Knotts, and Chuck and Rosemary McDonald. So happy birthday, happy anniversary, everybody there. And with that, if our ushers will come, we'll take up our morning offering. Jerry Eisner, if you'd pray for the offering, please. Amen. This time we have a special from the choir.
What a treasure. What a priceless gift we possess. The freedom to live and work and worship as we choose. That is why we can never lose sight of the fact that this freedom we enjoy daily was built upon the sacrifices of others. The sacrifices of ordinary men and women who gave their lives so we could enjoy ours.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir, for those messages and song. If I take our hymnals and turn to 531, America the Beautiful, and we'll go ahead and let the kids go downstairs for junior church. And just a reminder, there is no nursery worker, and I'm going to use this as a shameless plug. We're always looking for people to work in the nursery, so let us know if you'd be willing to take a Sunday. So, there we go. But still, we need more nursery workers. 531, stand as we sing. Joy plays the next verse. We'll let the choir go down and you get around and greet each other this morning. And the last verse. Oh, beautiful for patriotry that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster cities gleam undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed His grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Amen. You may be seated.
Of course, this is Memorial Day weekend, and we would really just not be doing the right thing if we did not take a moment to pay tribute and to give thanks for those who have made the greatest sacrifice so that we could enjoy the freedoms that we now have. That's really what Memorial Day is all about. It's more than just a kind of an unofficial beginning of summer and barbecues, and it's even more about than just a parade. It's about remembering those who have fallen and given their all in the defense of our country and so that we might have the freedoms that we do. So we have a short video clip this morning. It's about a minute and a half, close to 2 minutes in length. And just to pay tribute to those who gave their lives. I'd like for all of us to stand during this video clip. So let's all stand.
They are more than just names. More than blocks of stone set in rows. More than memories. They are our brothers and sisters. Our parents and our children. Friends, loved ones, and even strangers who believe that we were worth fighting for. That we were worth dying for. They stand for justice, for courage, for heroism and fearlessness in the face of danger. They stand for the brave men and women who selflessly answered the call and gave their very lives for the cause of freedom. Let us never take their sacrifice for granted, but instead, remember with gratitude those who have served. Today, tomorrow, and every day thereafter. By the grace of God, if we walk upon free soil, if we breathe in the sweetness of liberty, let us give thanks. Let us honor the fallen. And let us never forget.
Amen. Please be seated. Now we come to our prayer time. And again, we mentioned the coolers earlier. I'm going to mention prayer for them again. We're 12 coolers short of what we would like to have. And so we have 18, we need 30. There's a lot of water to distribute and it goes fast. So we need 12 more coolers. And if you're wondering how you can get them to the church, you can bring them by tonight. We'll be meeting over in the ministry center between 6 and probably just a little bit after 7. And so if you'd like to drop them off then, you can do so. Just bring them right inside the door there. But we need 12 more coolers. So if you would pray about that, and ask for the Lord to provide those. And then if you have a cooler, please bring that as well. So that's the first item on the prayer list. And then also, we do have the Bible study across the street, the last night of the four-week series on basic theology. And so we encourage you to come to that if you're a part of that study. And then also, we want to give thanks during this prayer time for those who have made the ultimate sacrifice. We just did that and paid tribute to the video. But let's give thanks to God as well. We also want to pray for Jada, that God will continue to bless her and work through her. That is just a tremendous illustration of what a church can do when you invest in your young people. When you pray for them, when you encourage them, when you support them, and you see how God's been working in her lives, in her life, and we have other lives as well, younger lives. And so let's pray for them, for the children, for the youth, for those who are just going out into the world, for Morgan, and for others. Let's pray that God use them, and let's continue to invest ourselves in them. We want to start at a very early age. Jada talked about being dedicated in this church, and that's really when it all begins. It's when they're babies. And so just pray for all of our young people, but especially for Jada. And in that regard, if we have, I think we have some visitors here this morning, but if you'd like to pick up on those little white cards, if you're a younger parent or a grandparent that has smaller children here, that's especially for you. Or if you'd like to share it with someone else and invite them to church, feel free to do that. It has the church contact information on the back of it. But it just has a few words of appreciation from us here at Beulah for you bringing your young children to church. I realize back in the day, and also now with a grandson and granddaughter, that it's a chore to get children to church. And so we appreciate you being here, and you're a great encouragement to us. And so we want to encourage you. We also want to pray for the Life Choice Pregnancy Center that Marilyn mentioned earlier. We want to vote pro-life. We also want to be aware of how we're voting. We want to pray but we have a tremendous opportunity to make a difference in the lives of these young women and to save children from being aborted. As they counsel with them, as she had a little model that she shows, and it's a child at 12 weeks. And you can see the hands and the arms and the feet and the face and all of that. And so that's one of the things that they use to counsel with the young women there. And then they have clothes and they have diapers. I won't give it all away because we want the ladies to go and see all that. But it's just a wonderful ministry to help not only children, but also to help young mothers and families. So, but pray for that we can get more involved in it. Then let's pray for our nation. We're encouraged in Scripture to pray for our nation. So especially on this patriotic weekend, let's pray for our country. We need prayer. And we also need boldness as God's people to stand on God's word and to share the gospel, to speak the truth in love. So let's pray for that as well. And then pray for the lost. Lost family members, lost friends, pray for them by name that God will move and work in their lives. So let's remember all of these things as we go to the Lord in prayer. Also those who are ill, we've got several in our congregation that certainly need our prayers, so pray for them. If you would like to come to the front and kneel down at the altar, feel free to do that. If you want to stay where you are, that's fine. But we're going to have a few moments of private meditation, then we'll be led together in our praying. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, this morning we praise you for your great faithfulness to us. In good times, in bad times, in sickness and in health, in want and in prosperity, you are always there for us. And Father, even though we don't understand how our lives may twist and turn and the circumstances around us, we know that you understand. We know that you are sovereign and that you're in control. So, Father, we place our trust not in our own initiative, not in our own abilities, not in our own skills, but we place our trust in you. And we look to you for wisdom and guidance, and we come before you humbly. And we pray, Father, that you would guide us in the ways that you would have us to go. May it not be our will. May it not be our ambition. May it not be our dreams that are achieved. But may your will be accomplished. May we please you in all that we do. And, oh, Father, we thank you so much for Beulah Baptist Church, for all the men and women of this church, for those who have served so faithfully, some who have gone on now to be with Christ. We know that through Christ we'll see them again. Because of that, we have great joy and hope. Father, we ask this morning that you would continue to move and work in our midst. We pray, Father, that you would guide our country. Father, for the president, for the Congress, for the Supreme Court, for other leaders, for state leaders and local leaders, Father, guide them in the way that you'd have them to go. We pray that you would work and you would move in their hearts and minds. And then, Father, we pray that you would send a great revival, but we don't just pray that you'd revive other people. Father, grant us the boldness to stand on your word and to speak your truth and love to a generation that is lost and dying in sin and a world that's becoming increasingly dark. Father, we ask your forgiveness for the times we could have shared and we didn't. For the times we could have spoken up for Christ and we kept our mouth shut. Father, grant us boldness that we may be faithful servants of yours. Father, we pray for Jada. We thank you so much for this open letter that she sent to us. And not only are we blessed by her appreciation, but we're blessed by the growth that we see because we've been obedient to you to invest our lives in her. Now we see the fruit that is being born that glorifies you. Father, may we learn a lesson from this and continue to invest in the lives of our children and our youth so that they may have a strong, sure foundation for their lives as they go out into the world. Father, we pray for the Life Choice Pregnancy Center. We thank you for the ministry these two Christian ladies have that run it. Father, may we do all we can to help them to save lives and to steer women in the direction that's pleasing to you and to share the Christian faith with them as the opportunities arise. Father, we pray for the lost, for our lost family members, for friends, for others. Father, we pray for them by name, and we want to do so every day. Convict them of their sins and draw them out of the darkness and into the light. Father, we pray for the parade that's coming up tomorrow, that everything would come together for that. We pray that the weather would be good. Father, may we have all the coolers that we need, not just so that we can be well equipped, but so that we can well represent you and we can be as powerful a witness as possible to share with others. Father, forgive us of our sins and help us as we approach this sermon time to grow from it, to take your word, to apply it to our lives, to be convicted if necessary, to be strengthened, to be challenged, and then to leave here with a joyful witness, knowing that we are rightly related to you and knowing that it's our heart's desire to serve you. Father, lead us, guide us, direct us, so that your Son Jesus may be glorified in every single thing that we do. For it's in the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Master, and our soon coming King that we pray. Amen. Jude verses 1 through 4 is the passage for this morning. Jude verses 1 through 4. Last Sunday, I began the message, Contend for the Faith. And I emphasized that all followers of Christ are engaged in a spiritual struggle. So whether or not you like it, whether or not you prefer to be there, you are a contender for the faith. And last Sunday, we talked about what it means to be a contender, that you compete, that you're in a competition, that you have an adversary, that you have to give a strenuous physical effort for that. It's nothing that you can just slide through and coast through. So the first point emphasized that to contend for the faith, to defend it and promote it, you must be in the faith. You must know Christ as your Savior. You must be right with God. You must be at peace with Him. And if you are not at peace with Jesus Christ, if you have not asked Christ to forgive you of your sins, today's the day of salvation. Ask Him to do so, and He will do so as you repent and call upon Him. So you find peace through Christ, through your past, and you may have had quite a shady past, things that you don't want other people to know or other people to realize. Christ will forgive all that. As you come to Him, He empowers you in the present. So you have peace with God in the present as you seek to serve Him. You have peace about the future because you know that God is in control. And then you have peace for all eternity because you know your place in heaven is secure, not because you're a good person, but because Christ died for you and you've received His righteousness. So the word contend means to strive or vie in contest or rivalry or against difficulties. It means to strive or to debate. So today is also Graduate Sunday, and we've already recognized a graduate, and a lot of churches across the country are recognizing graduates this time of year. Christian young people learn in a hurry that they must contend for their faith. It will be challenged morally and intellectually and culturally, and I would dare say now more so than at any time in the past couple of hundred years or so. So today is also Memorial Day Sunday, when the country gives respect and honor and thanks to those who made the ultimate sacrifice for their country. They contended
for their country by bearing arms and by sacrificing their very lives. So as followers of Christ, you and I are called to contend for the faith. Now, the faith is the gospel that's handed down to us from previous generations. It's biblical truth that points people to Jesus and what God has accomplished for mankind through him. A couple of scripture passages in that regard. 2 Corinthians 10, verses 4 through 5 says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God and take every thought captive to obey Christ." Then Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 12 says, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places." So the first place you contend for the faith is in your own heart and in your own mind. Through the gospel, you can be at peace with God in your heart and in your mind. That's the first way you contend for the faith. And you can't go any farther in that contending until you settle that. You must be at peace with God. Then after you are at peace with God, the contest, the defense of the faith continues. So second, you contend for the faith with a prepared mind. You contend for the faith with a prepared mind. Verse 3 says, "Beloved, although I was very eager to write you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints." Jude says, "I found it necessary." Now, although he would have loved to have just sat back and praised the Lord through this whole letter and thanked God for all the blessings that they had been given, there was work that needed to be done. There was a challenge that needed to be addressed. Throughout the history of the church, there have always been challenges to the faith. So it's critical not only to have your heart right with God, but to have your mind prepared with biblical truth to contend for the faith. Romans 12:2 says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind." So the mental challenge to the faith was strong at the time Jude was writing this letter. The challenge mentally to the faith is strong today as well. Whether or not you recognize that, whether or not you want to admit that, that's the case. So it's essential to guard your mind and equip your mind to defend the truth of the gospel. Now, the scripture is filled with references about using your mind to glorify God and to serve him. Romans 8, 5 through 6 says, "For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace." Colossians 3, 2 says, "Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on the earth." There's an old advertising slogan, I think it's just about as old as I am, and it says, "A mind is a terrible thing to waste." Learn to think about your faith. Don't just read your Bible, study your Bible, memorize Bible verses, meditate upon Scripture, understand basic doctrine. Now, as I've already mentioned a couple of times, there's a good book study that's wrapping up tonight on bite-sized theology. If you haven't participated and you'd like to have done so, let me know. We will offer it again because it's important for you to have a basic grasp of biblical theology. But those things are just a few of the ways that you can contend for your faith with your mind. The tendency for many Christians today when it comes to drawing near to God is just to disengage the mind and to let the emotions run wild. And so when you come to church, it's all about how I felt and the experience that I had and how blessed I may have been. Now, don't get me wrong. I love that aspect of the Christian faith. I love the joy that I feel when I come together with God's people. There is a joy, there is a peace, there is a warmth, there is an excitement. I get very passionate about it, in case you couldn't tell. So it's amazing, powerful thing. But we also need to learn how to use our mind to glorify God and to serve Him. Something isn't right if you're not using both. If you don't have the emotions and you're not using your mind. Following Jesus, contending for the faith, is very much about using your mind, thinking biblically as God would have you to think. Now, you are constantly bombarded with messages to think according to the world. You get those messages through the media. You get them through the movies. You get them through secular education. You get them through music. They're coming at you time and time and time again, wanting you to think according to the ways of this world. You need to have your mind renewed constantly with Scripture. Learn how to serve God with your mind. Younger generations especially have their minds greatly influenced through social media. There's texting. There's all kinds of social media. There are branches of the social media I'm not even aware of. Your mind as a child of God, whether you're younger or whether you're older, is constantly under assault by the enemy. So have your mind prepared to contend for the faith. Ephesians 6, 10 through 18 is the well-known passage about putting on the armor of God. Verse 11 says to put on that armor in order to stand against the devil's schemes, his cunning, his deception, his ungodly ways of wanting you to think. The wrestling in verse 12 that's mentioned there, it's not physical. It's mental. It's spiritual. A well-equipped mind, a godly mind in this day and age is critical. Don't waste your mind when it comes to serving God. Here's the list of the armor in Ephesians 6. The belt of truth. You know truth from error. You're girded with the belt of truth. You're able to discern the two. The breastplate of righteousness, knowing that you have the righteousness that Jesus has given to you, that it's not of your own, it's from God, it's His righteousness. That protects you. Shoes of the gospel of peace. You know why you're at peace with God, and you're ready to share it with others whenever the opportunity arises. The shield of faith. You know and you trust that God's way for you is always the right way. The helmet of salvation. Your mind is guarded and renewed by being in Christ, your Savior. And finally, the sword of the Spirit. You know the Word of God, and you know how to use the Word of God. And you're learning more about it and more how to use it every day. All of these things have to do with your mind. Contend for the faith with a prepared mind. Then third, contend for the faith with a watchful eye. With a watchful eye. Verse 4 says, for certain people have crept in unnoticed who long ago were designated for condemnation. Ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Now there are five things to notice about the people that Jude is describing from this passage. First of all, they are intruders who don't belong. Now, that's the case in Jude's day. That's the case in our day. There are intruders who come along who act as if they're in the church and part of the body of Christ, but in reality, they're not. Jesus warns of this kind of intruder in Matthew 7, verses 15 through 17. He says, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? So every healthy tree bears fruit, but the diseased tree bears bad fruit. You recognize them by their deeds, by their fruit. Do they point people to Christ, or do they point people to themselves? Is it all about Jesus and bringing glory to Him, or is it more focused about the things that are going on in their lives and their ministries? Second, they have already been judged. God has a plan to deal with them in His time and in His way. Don't let them trouble you. Run from them. Don't be involved with them, but don't be troubled by that. God will take care of that. Matthew 7 continues in verses 19 through 20. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will recognize them by their fruits. Third, they are ungodly. Now, this is an important thing to grasp here. The Greek could also be translated irreverent or impious. There is a lack of reverence for God and a lack of humility before Him. Now, if you turn on your television set or you open up a book or you see somebody online or in a YouTube video or whatever, and they start talking about the big guy upstairs and they're trying to teach you something about God's Word, you need to start going somewhere else, because there's no reverence there. There's no humility there. And that's one of the characteristics of that. It's more about them and about their message than it is about Almighty God. And so we need to understand that there is an ungodliness there. There's a lack of reverence that is present. Philippians 3, verses 18 through 19 says, "For many, of whom I have often told you and now tell you even with tears, walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their end is destruction, their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame, with minds set on earthly things. Fourth, they pervert the grace of God and make it a license for all kinds of ungodly behavior and immorality." And the message that you basically hear is, don't do what's right in God's eyes and what Scripture may tell you to do. Do what feels good for you, because God loves you and He wants you to have the fullest expression of yourself, regardless of how ungodly it may be or how it may be prohibited in Scriptures. Don't worry about doing right and wrong. Just do what's right for you. That's the best thing. And that's not a biblical godly teaching. 2 Timothy 4, verses 3 through 4 says, "For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but will, having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. Fifth, they deny the Lord Jesus Christ." Now, they may acknowledge Him, but they show no evidence of submitting to Him as Lord and Master. Colossians 2:8 says, "See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ." There are people today who claim the name of Christian and who even have an ordained status, who are sharing things about how you should live as a Christian that I cannot describe to you in this church service. They would be too much out of place. They would be too indecent. And yet that's the kind of thing that's being promoted and shared today in many places. So contend for the faith with a watchful eye. So how can you identify them based upon this passage? We have some insights, but what else can you do? Well, I found that some of the worst things being taught to believers are being promoted by the most likable of personalities. The false teachers aren't the ones who are just, you know, you just hate being around them, and maybe they just rub you the wrong way and you don't want to listen to anything else they have to say. Typically, they're very cunning and they're very smooth and they're very likable, warm personalities, very charming, very engaging, and often they'll have very large crowds and they'll sell a great number of books. They know how to work a crowd. They know how to speak eloquently and convincingly. They know how to move people emotionally. So after you've heard that person, you may think, oh boy, I feel pretty good as a result of all that. But based on Jude 4, they display a lack of reverence and humility when it comes to Almighty God, and especially when it comes to the truth of His Word. So they twist the marvelous, wonderful grace of God into permission for you to indulge your sinful nature and say that's okay because it's all about you. They don't speak of how you can serve Jesus, how you can deny yourself, how you can take up your cross, but instead, how can Jesus serve you? How can the Lord help you today and in every area of your life? It's not about you. It's about God and about glorifying Him and living in a way that points others to Him. 1 Peter 5:8 says, "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." Now, if God's word is true, and it is true, and we have an adversary that's out there wanting to destroy us, it behooves us to be prepared. It's the smart thing to do. You just don't lounge around casually. You have a prepared mind. You have a watchful eye. You are right with God, and you're ready to defend your faith when the time comes to do so. Contend for the faith with a watchful eye. So this morning, are you ready to contend for your faith? That's God's call to you this morning. That's God's call to me. And really, we don't have an option in that. We can't opt out and just sit over to the side. All of us are involved in this spiritual struggle. Being a contender for the faith begins with having a peaceful heart towards God rather than a rebellious heart. If you're telling God, in essence, Lord, I'd rather do things my way rather than your way. I'll get around to doing things your way later. You are rebelling against God. Today's the day of salvation. You need to get right with God today. So stop insisting on doing things in your time and your way and turn to the Lord Jesus now. Ask him to save you of your sin. Call upon him as his Holy Spirit has already been working with you. Second, prepare your mind and keep it prepared. Don't let your mind go to waste as a child of God. We work to educate ourselves in all other areas of life, for our vocations, for school, and that sort of thing. But often when it comes to God's word and when it comes to spiritual matters, we just turn off our minds, and that should not be so. Be ready to contend for your faith. Read God's word. Study it. Spend time in prayer individually and with other believers. Third, be on the lookout for dangers to the faith, especially those who are very smooth and for those who are very likable and for those who are very charming, who would knowingly or unknowingly seek to turn people from the faith. God is calling you this morning to contend for the faith. Will you obey him? Will you rise to the challenge? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this passage of scripture that you've given us, and we thank you for the truth that it has for our lives. Father, forgive us for the times when we've gone into battle and we've just been unprepared. We haven't thought about it. We haven't prayed. We haven't studied our scripture. We're just kind of lax about the whole thing. Father, that's a field day for the enemy. And Father, we know in this day and age, it's so easy to be misled. There are so many that talk smoothly. There are so many that cherry pick scriptures and pull them out of context in order to support their arguments. And so, Father, may we be ready. May we have minds that are prepared. May we have eyes that are perceptive so that we can be very devoted to you and so that we can make a great difference in this world around us. Father, give us peaceful hearts. Give us prepared minds. Give us perceptive eyes that we may serve you in greater ways and that we may truly be salt and light in this day in which we live. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. If you're here this morning and you've never made a decision for Christ, I strongly encourage you to come forward and to get right with God. We can pray together. You can call upon Christ to forgive you of your sin. Coming forward won't save you, but calling upon Christ to save you will. So if you want to come and pray together, that would be a wonderful thing. But today's the day. Now's the time. If you're here and you'd like to rededicate your life publicly, then do that. If you're here this morning, you'd like to join this church family officially, we'd love to talk more about it with you. So if you'd come in response to God's leading as well. Our hymn of invitation is number 374. Number 374, Jesus Calls Us. Let's stand and sing the first and last verses. Remember the need for 12 more coolers so that we can be well equipped for tomorrow. Jason Griffith, would you close us in prayer, please?